All right, traders, good afternoon. This is Christian Farmer at Strabag and Trade Group, and it is Monday, November 9th. So a bit of things to get through today. Shaky price action, you know, big news, of course, this morning coming that the vaccine may be on its way with Pfizer and also some other companies, too. So, you know, that basically caused, you know, a major rotation into out of some of these stay-at-home stocks, all things that you guys have been hearing about throughout the day. So, you know, there's not much, you know, I can go through this, but I think you kind of know already that, yeah, you know, there's been a lot of money that have been hiding out into, you know, growth names. I thought what Druckenmiller said on CNBC earlier was interesting. You know, the digitalization, you know, that has been a trend that got accelerated during COVID, right? So things got, you know, a bit ahead of themselves in terms of that. And as he described it, overvalued. So this was also, I think, you know, a catalyst a bit for the day. You can kind of see what he read here. You've had a bunch of equities benefiting greatly from work from home, Druckenmiller said. A lot of money has rotated into them. They are overvalued. I don't disagree with that statement, right? We know that some of these names have gone up way much farther than names that have gotten hurt by COVID. So, you know, if there is a vaccine coming, which is great, you know, bottom line, it's really good that we're going to get a vaccine that's going to help a lot of businesses. And of course, you know, what we saw today was kind of a snapback rally in some of those areas. He continued to say, but then you've got a whole other sector of the market that has struggled mightily because of COVID. He said they're selling at undervalue relative to, say, a 3 to 5 year outlook. So the rotation into them would seem entirely rational. He put it a great way, and of course I can't put it better than what a famous, you know, investor says here. But I think, you know, the only thing that I would say more than a sector, you know, a few sectors. And then it just kind of felt like overall for the day, you know, when we look at this performance, you know, what we've seen before when they rotate hard into value. Because if you look at the groups today, you know, of course, travel stocks, you know, and those, you know, areas where you know that are COVID sensitive, you know, those, you know, rallied very hard. But then there was a number of other areas like energy, right? I mean, this is pretty crazy, right? XOP was up 16% for the day. Again, you know, make sure that the most important thing is you do look at the performance for the day. I just like to kind of go over what rallied and what sold off, because it really kind of gives you a sense of what transpired during the trading session, right? The overnight moves are one thing, and you know, I discussed them quite a bit in other videos, how the overnight move is generally bigger than the intraday move. But, you know, even though the Dow, you know, I'll just start there, or the small caps, maybe I'll even start there, you know, sold off 4% for the day, they still finished up 3.7%. So, you know, a very unusual day in multiple facets. But, you know, I always see like stats thrown around on days like this. Well, you know, meaning stats that I see, well, this is the first time that this has happened in 20 years, or this is the first time that this has happened in such and such time. You know, I really dislike these comparisons because we didn't have COVID in any of those. We, you know, I think this is one of the most unusual years that I've ever seen trading. And I hope that it will. I hope that we don't see a repeat of some of these things, like, you know, that are COVID related, right? So you could just have to realize that we're going to see a number of those stats. Well, this is the first time that this has happened in years. Yes, I mean, this is the first time that we've had a virus that has shut down the country in 100 years. So just keep that in mind. We're in a very unusual time. And, you know, the fact that all these areas, you know, the software, well, you know, multiple other growth areas, right, that have done extremely well, there's going to be some rotation out of this. Now, the other thing that you have to kind of realize with the rotation, you know, is that these growth areas are much larger than the value sectors, right? And that's just because they've grown in value. You know, they've grown, I don't want to say value again, they've grown in size. So this typically does happen when there's a rotation from growth to value. The indices get hit a bit because they are, the growth is such a larger, you know, area. So, again, big moves out of oil, gas, the banks carry up 15.4%. When I was on Bloomberg last week, this was pre-election. You know, again, there's so many things that are going on right now. You know, we had the election last week. Just a number of events. You know, and this one, while is good, right? That we are getting a vaccine from, but from a market perspective, it's another big event, right? That you know, money is going to shift around quite a bit. So as I've said in weeks past, you know, this market that we have in front of us is one of the most interesting things out there. It's the most interesting show that I think is out there is what's been going on in this stock market. What else before I kind of get to some of those? I want to try to bring up the question if, you know, how much more could be rotated into value. I'll get to that in a second. Look at the move in bonds today too, right? So, like I said, a lot of dynamics going on, right? This started to take place, you know, a couple weeks back, rallied a little bit, you know, kind of a counter trend rally last week. But you could see these bonds, you know, are now back to this level. They're, you know, they broke below the 200-day moving average. If you want to see what bond, longer dated bond futures look like, we are now, we did close below last week's close. So, you know, it's kind of interesting, you know, remember that after last election, and this may just be a coincidence, you know, rates went higher, right? And remember, when bonds go lower, rates go higher. So I'm looking at bonds right now. But remember, after last election, bonds went lower, rates went higher, and, you know, the banks rallied hard. So it's kind of interesting that it's doing it again, but for different reasons, right? So here's what we have with the regional banks. You know, could they continue to rally? Well, let's zoom out. Right? I mean, they're not even, you know, they're about halfway through. You know, they're up, you know, just a little bit higher than where they were in June. So this could carry for a little bit. I see resistance up at 50.36. You know, one, you know, and you could look at this in terms of XLF too, the financials ETF, if you don't want to just look at the straight banks. This is a little bit stronger. This is in value. Next resistance is going to be 28.27, right, which is going to be, you know, right in here on the daily chart. JP Morgan, which I view as one of the stronger banks, you could see that this thing, you know, could really go further here. You know, JP Morgan, if it wants to, it is now above value for the year. So if it holds up here, you could use 111, you know, for JP Morgan. And there's a 134 VPOC up there. So who knows? How does this look, you know, if we break apart a couple of the, you know, one of the ratio charts that I look at is IWN as in Nancy, IWO, the small cap value versus small cap growth. This is when I was on Bloomberg last week, I mentioned that if you did not have exposure to value, that this could be a trade that you put on, specifically IWN, you know, long, small cap value. So that worked out. I think that worked out very well. You know, this was up 7% for the day, small cap value, impressive. If you look at the other one, small cap growth, was essentially, you know, well, was up 1% for the day. All right. So when we look at this relationship, I don't have the answer to this question, and I don't have I don't have answers to any, you know, questions regarding if something is starting to, you know, start to move and has a big move. One thing that you could kind of look at this is this relationship over the last year, value versus growth. If it wants to get going and wants to go further, right, we could look at maybe a five-year chart of this, right? And here was the last, this is where value rallied hard last time, or last election, post-election. You know, look at where we are now. So just put this in perspective, right? If you're thinking about jumping back into growth stocks, you know, have a level to trade against, in my opinion, and you know, make sure that you're honoring that. I thought it was particularly difficult. I had a couple trades on from last week, and they already they blew through the stop price pre-market. So I said, okay, well, let's see how they do in the first half of the day. I knew I was going to be busy with you know, some of the names that I had more value-ish names on too, like DuPont, going into today, which worked pretty well. But I said, hey, let's give a couple things like CrowdStrike a chance to see if you know, it's not completely stay at home. I get that cyber stocks have gotten a boost from COVID, right? So, but they obviously got brought down with it. But yeah, this is what this chart looks like. So for me, you know, I would say, you know, see if you can find a couple things in this space. My thought as well on value, I never liked this value versus growth complete argument. I like to own quality. So, and I do try to kind of, you know, look for quality in various different groups, right? So, in, you know, in the TTG trend portfolio, I've got a couple things like I've got Honeywell on, right, which I view a quality name. I actually put in the industrial ETF in there too, which did decently today, and the materials ETF. So if you can kind of look at it that way, I think growth investors sometimes they really shun the other side, right, of value. But you know, if you can find a couple names that you like, and that you can find that, you know, if you have conviction in those names to kind of stick through them a little bit, you know, even though, you know, sometimes people give up on them right away because they haven't worked very well over the last year. You know, they've rallied one or two days and then they revert. So, you know, we saw that just about a week ago too, right? Before the election, value was doing okay. And then once the, you know, last week, growth outperformed a bit. So you got, you know, my opinion, try to find a couple names that can add some add a little bit of diversification, that are good quality sound names, right? And forget about, you know, that whole, oh, well, I got to jump into all these value stocks now, right? I think for me, like, that's the best way to tackle it. All right, so that's that. What else did I? Oh, I was going to show today's trades. Horrible day of trading for me. I traded a little bit of Amazon pre-market. The reason why I would say horrible, like, I just knew whenever you have these gap up days, they are not my days to trade. They are very difficult to trade gap up days, right? When we start up. And this was an unusual case today, but, you know, normally, like, if we start up, like, you know, before this happened, the market was already up over 1% going into the open. You know, I remember kind of last night and saying, okay, well, this is probably going to be, for me, a day where I sell the open and then, you know, maybe look for, like, a day trade for the day. But that's it. Like, these gap up days are days, for me, where I just want to be selling the open, and then wait until things settle in, and then kind of go from there. This was different, right? This was different because it was a gap open day for the banks, for the industrials, for some of the material names, for the travel names, but it wasn't a gap up for, you know, the NASDAQ name. So, you know, I saw Amazon getting, you know, hit pre-market, so, you know, I played that for a little bit of bounce. That was fine. I traded a little bit of small, right? Macy's on the, you know, pre-market, because I thought it might get a pop on the open. Big short interest there at Macy's. But then things kind of went downhill for me. So again, you know, we had some problems with various different brokerage systems. I could tell you, I would not get too excited about that. That's happened to me before. You know, even when I was an institutional trader, we used to have problems with our systems too. When the market is very volatile, it's just going to happen. So while frustrating, and I heard a couple systems were really bad, you know, for like over an hour today, it's very, very frustrating. But, you know, have a talk with your broker and, you know, maybe they can do something for you. But I could tell you, I did hear a couple brokerage firms that were fine for the day. So, you know, that kind of tells you something. But, on average, when there's a lot of movers and volatility around the open, systems fail for a little bit. It is quite, I hate to say ordinary, but these systems just can't handle that volatility. So be mindful of that. It's good to have a backup system. Like if you're doing a lot of trading in one account, it is nice to have another system that you can use and you can log into for emergency purposes, because they will, right? These retail brokerage systems, they're going to go down from time to time, right? So, you know, take a deep breath when that happens. It's very frustrating, obviously, but, you know, a lot of systems had those issues today. All right, so then, you know, it was even tough getting some fills. I tried getting in some SE today on the dip. You know, that worked well. Where's my exit? Oh, here it is. All right, that worked really well. Tesla worked well for a minute. you know, that's why you have to hit targets. But again, you know, some of these things, it's funny because somebody asked me about this on Twitter, because I posted this chart on Sunday morning, I believe. And I said, hey, Tesla just has to get over 445, right, to trigger for a long, right? Well, it has to close there. And they said, well, what do you do? How do you tackle that if it starts to go up intraday? And I said, well, I usually start a position with the mindset, of course, that the closing print has to be, right? You want to see a full green candle for the day. This was not it, right? So that's a fake out, right? And that's a failed move. So what do? If you tried doing something like this, like I did, right, getting into Tesla, I hit a target, small target, right? And then I got stopped out on the balance. Right. Where'd this thing close? Yeah, 421. So I guess I did a good job at that. A couple other things, not the smartest thing. You know, Apple was another one of the weekend watch list setups. Needed to close above 120, didn't do it. Right. I did not stop myself out of this one. So I'm sitting in some pain. So like I said, I did not trade today very well. It happens. I added to this thing too, and sometimes you're going to get these days where buying the dip doesn't work. That was today. You know, keep in mind, we hear that term a lot, buy the dip, buy the dip, buy the dip. That works a lot, right? But there's going to be times where we have multiple day sell-offs. I do like looking at Apple too when there is this rotation, because Apple's kind of a little bit in the middle between value and growth. I did look at the PE ratio. It probably is considered more growth now than anything else. McDonald's, I tried trading a little bit of that. That was fine. That worked. Crowd, here's my exit from Friday's entry. I did take one target on Friday, but then this Lowe's killed me. This was probably the problem of the day. PayPal, I tried buying a little bit of PayPal on the dip earlier. I didn't like how that, you know, that just could not get any momentum to it. So stopped out of that one. And then I played some Q's puts, right? So Q's on the 5-minute bar. Once we broke value, right? Because we weren't down that much at that point. Once we broke value, you know, then we started to accelerate to the downside. So a little bit of puts worked. But all in all, I've got some issues with some things that I did not stop myself out at. So, you know, I restructured this Lowe's trade, and then it kind of just waterfall down after that. So, and they announced that they're buying HDS, which is usually when a name acquires another company. It's not the best. It's not the best sign, but down 9%. Right. So keep in mind, right now this looks like a horrible looking candle the way this thing closed. So it looks like a kind of abstract head and shoulders. So I may have to stop myself out of that trade tomorrow. That's a bummer. It's a bummer taking stops on trades. I was doing that. You know, I did that like right off the bat with the name that I talked about on Friday too, Carvana. The reason why sometimes, sometimes I'll even get out before I hit a stop. Because if I've got three or four problems going on, I like to at least get out of one of the problems, right? Because I had Carvana on, I had CrowdStrike on, I had Lowe's on. And I think there was one more to me, yeah, one more small one maybe, but yeah, it's too many problems, right? So when you've got that going on, if you're watching all these, if you're trying to manage all these issues that you've got going on, you can't pay attention to the tape and what the tape is telling you, right? So I do that quite a bit. Sometimes I'll stop myself out of a trade that hasn't hit a stop. But then I just kind of said, okay, I got to throw in the towel on a couple of these things. So yeah, these days are never easy when you're kind of caught in some trades like that. So, the best thing that you could do is stick to your plan and regroup a little bit after that, right? So that's the situation that's trading, guys. You know, last week was a really nice week. Today was obviously, good news for the vaccine, right? I don't want to discount that, but in terms of trading, a big curveball for what we expected today. And I do agree with this statement here, right, from Mr. Drunken Miller about certain areas could really see perhaps a bigger move, right? That have been kind of pinned down because of COVID. So we'll see. We'll take it one, day by day. One name I would watch for tomorrow is what I already mentioned, is JP Morgan. This name I think is a quality name, and I don't see any major resistance in front of it. Right? It's a little bit overbought on the 1 hour, so maybe it does pull back a little bit. And I didn't do anything. I don't like to chase, especially banks. I'll wait till the banks kind of come to me. And if I miss them, I miss them, right? If that's a trade that I want to do. All right, guys, we'll leave it there. Sometimes the market, will do some really good things in your favor. And sometimes it's going to do, it's number one, it's going to do whatever it wants to. So you kind of have to control what you can control, which is your risk. All right, guys, have a great night. See you tomorrow.